Oi. See that bloke over there?
Me?
There, standing by the bar. He's the one hiring men. Says it's for a voyage of discovery. Discovery.
Where to?
North Pole. Well, what's to discover there, except ice and polar bears?
What's the pay?
Oh, polar bears, icebergs, enough to freeze
How much is the pay?
Oh, I don't know. You best ask him yourself. Well, I don't think he's got much of a crew yet. None of the Russian crews can understand a bloody word he says. I seen him wandering around the quayside.
You'll be glad of the work if you want to clean your slate at the bar. Now stay here. I'll have a word with that young gent.
No one gets to the North Pole. You won't be back, and I'm not coming with you.
Begging your pardon, sir, but are you the man looking for a crew?
Indeed I am, sir. Would you be offering your services?
Ah, steady, sir, steady. I might be if the pay was right.
I can pay you double any rate paid on any ship you may find in port. But I feel sure that once I have described the nature of our journey,
you will... For you to pay such rates, sir, your journey must be full of dangers. North Pole. No one's ever got that far north and lived. Come to that, no one knows for certain where it is.
Sir, this expedition is in the cause of science. Every man who comes with me will partake of the glory. I am determined to discover the source and origin of the power that attracts the needle of every compass. History is in the making, sir. I have
How
no doubt...
How many sailors have you got so far, sir?
I have not. The Russian seamen here in Archangel do not seem to understand the importance of the expedition. But I have no doubt that the North Pole has secrets locked within its frozen wastes. Science and all mankind will benefit from this great expedition. We will see a world never before visited, and may tread a land never before imprinted by the foot of man.
You have a ship, sir?
Of course. Our discoveries will unlock great benefits, which I shall confer on all mankind to the last generation. I have no doubt we will find a passage across the pole which will enable travel from...
Where's the ship berth, sir?
The ship? Oh, yes. At the customs yard. The Enterprise.
Oh, a trem ship, sir. A wise choice, just suited to Arctic waters. You've had good advice, at least.
I see. You think I am a novice, sir? Well, I have spent 6 years on whalers in the North Sea and have served as a second mate. I know a good ship and a good seaman when I see one.
No, I meant no offence, sir.
And there is none taken. Well, will you find me a crew? I intend to leave port within a week.
Aye, aye, sir. Within a week.
A waste of bloody time. There'll be nothing there but ice and more ice.
Who took the pee? Now keep your mouth shut. Good man and a good sailor.
Oh, yeah. Like the rest of this crew, everyone is sane. Have you seen the master? Well, I wouldn't treat seamen the way he does. Kid gloves, smiles, nods and bloody winks.
He is a gentleman.
He's a fool. You mark my words. Men at sea need discipline. If things get rough out there, if the meat runs short, he won't keep that smile. Here, I heard some tale. Did you know he was in love with a Russian lady? Well, along comes this young, handsome lad, and the Russian lady, well, she falls in love with him. Now, her father had agreed to let our master marry this girl, but before the knot was tied, she told him straight out, I love another. And what did the old fool do? He lets her go. He even says, I'll plead with her old man to let her marry this young man who hadn't got a penny. Oh, well, that just shows you the kind of man he is. Nothing but a fool.
I should have let you soak in your liver in rum. If anything should happen, you will be no use to any man. Not out here, this far out. Mr. Walton stands up on the bridge smiling. But does he know where he's going? And what are we really after? And did he tell me the truth? I'd give a month's pay to know what's going on behind that smile.
Good progress. And all the men seem quite content. No one has yet complained, despite the floating sheets of ice that pass us every hour. We are getting closer. Closer to success. I will discover things that have been scarcely dreamed of. Success shall crown my endeavors. What can stop the determined heart and resolved will of man? Nothing.
No, I don't believe this. I just don't. Oh, I was a fool to listen to you. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, the pay is good. We sail in summer. Oh, will you look at that ice? We're locked in.
Joseph.
Locked in on every side. The ice will crack this coracle like a nut. We've no sea room.
Keep your eyes out, damn you.
For what? You can't see your hand in front of your bloody face. We're sailing blind.
We dropped anchor an hour ago. The sun will suck this fog away and then we'll see how we stand.
Oh, yes. 1,000 miles from anywhere and nowhere turning back.
Turning back? Oh, Mr. Smith, I'll hear no talk of turning back. We've not seen a glimpse of the pole. How can you talk of turning back?
Oh, Mr. Walton, sir, I didn't see you there. I was some...
You must keep your spirits up, Mr. Smith. This fog will clear and then we will see the way forward. And if we are deserving, our patience will be rewarded. We will see wonders. Wonders which will be of benefit to all mankind. And you will be there, Mr. Smith. You will be there.
Yes, Mr. Walton. If I don't freeze to death first.
Good. Now, gentlemen, I believe it is your watch. You must inform me when the mist clears. I will be below.
Aye, aye, sir.
So, the fog is clearing. So? We're still trapped in the ice. The ship's not moving at all now. No sun can melt
it. Shut up. One more word, just one more word, and by heaven Keep your eyes on the ice.
So, I see. In the interests of science, we might just see the pole and learn all the secrets of nature. Oh, yes.
What's that?
See wonders. See madmen, more like.
Get below. Tell Mr. Walton to come up here right away.
What do you mean?
Just do it.
Where?
There, sir. Just beyond that ice floe.
Good God. What, a man on a sledge here?
Yes, sir.
But we are hundreds of miles from the nearest human settlement. How on earth?
Perhaps we're not so far north as we thought, Mr. Walton.
I have an exact position for this vessel, Mr. Smith.
Mr. Walton, take a look through this telescope. I think there's something strange about it. Take a look, sir.
Yes. Yes. There's a man driving the sledge. But he is... He appears to be of gigantic stature.
A wonder, Mr. Walton, sir. A wonder. Mind you, could be a trick of the light.
Indeed, Mr. Smith. A very scientific approach. But whether or not the man was a giant or not is immaterial. We have 3 witnesses to the fact that there was a man driving hard across the ice floes. And that is a fact, albeit marvelous. You will remain on watch, gentlemen. If you please, I will be below should this apparition reappear.
Aye, aye, sir.
If my charts are correct and I am not in error, then we cannot be within 400 miles of any habitation. How can it be? A man with dogs driving across such a wasteland. Perhaps I'm wrong. Perhaps we have not come so far. And yet we must be farther north. We must be. The ice bears witness to that fact. The ice. A testament to our true isolation and our greatest danger. Already the men are beginning to groan and complain. Surely it cannot hold us for long. It is still summer. It must break. It must. Tomorrow we will be free.
Mr. Walton! Mr. Walton! You'll not believe this, sir. You'll not credit it. There's a man. Well, he's not a giant or nothing, sir, but he's there.
What is the matter now?
Nothing, sir, only there's this man over the side. He's just sitting there on this ice floe on his sledge. But he won't come on board. We've tried to persuade him. He looks half dead just sitting there.
Good morning. May we offer you any assistance? You're welcome to come aboard.
Before I come aboard your vessel, will you have the kindness to inform me whether you are bound?
Good God, is the man mad? This ship is his only hope of salvation, and he asks me where we're going. His hands are frozen to his sledge, and his face is purple with the cold. I have never seen a man in so wretched a condition.
Sir, we are bound for the North Pole on a voyage of discovery.
And I should be happy to join you.
I think our guest will need some assistance.
Come along, sir.
Take him below. Get some blankets.
Aye, aye, sir.
Aye, aye, sir.
The thing is, sir, I mean, what me and the lads would like to know is, how did you come to be out on the ice? I mean, it was a rash thing to do, all on your own. Why'd you come so far out of your way?
To seek one who fled me.
Oh, so you're looking for someone. Did the man you were after, did he travel in the same fashion?
Yes.
Well, then I fancy we've seen him. The day before we picked you up, we saw some dogs join a sledge with a man in it across the ice.
What? You've seen him? You've seen the demon? Where did he go? Tell me.
No, sir. There's no need to get yourself all excited. He's gone now. That was days ago.
No. I will find him. He shall not escape. He shall not.
Gentlemen, what is going on here? I left specific instructions that our guest should be left in peace. I will not have him disturbed in this way. Do I make myself clear?
Oh, yes, sir. I told that to Mr. Rogers. I said...
Convey our guest to my cabin.
You must not chide your men. I have doubtless excited your curiosity as well as that of these good people. But you are too considerate to make inquiries.
I would not wish to trouble you with any inquisitiveness of mine.
And yet you rescued me from a strained and perilous fate. You restored me to life. But you will not ask me how I come to be where no man has been before. Tell me, when the ice broke, did it destroy the other sledge?
The other sledge? Oh, yes. I could not say. We saw the other sledge at noon, and the ice did not start to break until near midnight. The traveller could well have arrived at a place of safety well before that time, but I fear I cannot be certain.
Then I must watch. I can lose no time. I must go on deck. Perhaps he is close by. I must go on deck.
Please, you do not have the strength. If it is so important to find the other traveller, then
it is imperative. He must be found.
Then I will see that a watch is kept. But you must rest.
You will tell me. You will tell me immediately if you see the sledge.
Yes, yes, immediately. Now, please, you must rest. A month has passed. And with each succeeding day, my guest improves in health. He shows himself to be a true gentleman. He has won the admiration of the whole crew for his gentle manners and his kindly disposition. I begin to love him as a brother. He takes great pains to discuss my projects. I hope they serve at least to distract him from the burden of the misery he seems to carry.
I have spent every last penny, sacrificed my entire fortune to the success of this enterprise. I have no doubt that one man's death is but a small price to pay for knowledge. I am sure that this expedition will benefit all mankind. The secrets I hope to unlock will give man the power to dominate the elemental foes of our race. The sea, the wind, the... I predict that...
Oh, do you share my madness? You must not drink the same poison. You are still young. You must not. I will dash that cup from your lips. I will tell you my story. Prepare to hear of things beyond your understanding. Perhaps here, among the pitiless ice, in such a savage and mysterious place, it may not seem so marvelous. Perhaps you will believe. I am by birth a Genovese, and my family is one of the most distinguished of the Republic of Genoa. My father was both honorable and just, my mother kind and gentle. Much as they were attached to each other, they seemed to draw inexhaustible stores of affection from a very mine of love to bestow upon me. My mother's tender caresses, my father's smile of benevolent pleasure are my first recollections. I was their child, the innocent and helpless creature bestowed on them by heaven. My future was in their hands, to direct to happiness or misery. Every hour of my infant life I received a lesson of patience, of charity, and of self-control. Life was but one train of enjoyment. For a long time I was their only care. My mother had much desired to have a daughter, but I continued their single offspring. When I was about 5 years old, they passed a week on the shores of Lake Como while making an excursion beyond the frontiers of Italy. My mother often chose to enter the hovels of the poor in order to relieve them in some way of the burden of poverty. This to her was more than a duty, it was a passion. She had to be the guardian angel to the afflicted. During one of her visits, she noticed among the filth a group of children squatting round a small pot. An old man stirred the scanty gruel and struck out at any child who dared to lick more than his share from his long spoon.
That's enough.
Sir?
Oh, we ain't done nothing. This is ours. Nothing stolen.
Please, I'm not suggesting that. Please, I would like to be able to help. You have so many children, and... there does not seem to be sufficient food for you all. I would like to help.
Why? What do you want? We don't need your sort round here.
Are they all your children? Where is their mother?
Dead. Died of cold last winter.
Oh, I am so sorry.
Yeah, so was I. Now I have to look after the little bleeders. Here, what are you looking at? Ah, the blonde one. Nah, she ain't one of mine. She was given us to look after. When times was better, well, we got stuck with her. Parents died, didn't they?
What is her name?
Can't remember. Call her what you like. She comes running when I bang the spoon.
My mother was enchanted by this extraordinary creature. Her hair was the brightest living gold, her blue eyes cloudless, and her lips, and the moulding of her face so expressive of sensibility and sweetness that none could behold her without looking on her as a distinct species, a being heaven-sent, and bearing the celestial stamp in all her features.
Please, good sir, might I ask a great favour?
Favour? From me? Ask away.
You do not have enough food to feed your own children. Let me take this girl and bring her up. It would relieve the burden upon your own family and...
Why don't you take the lot if you're so keen on brats?
But then...
Nah, I wouldn't part with the little cherubs. Not one. Not even the blonde one. Except for a prize.
My mother would not buy the child, although she did consent to give the peasant what aid she could to relieve the burden of his poverty. And so it was I gained a sister, Elizabeth, as she became known. Everyone loved her. The passionate and almost reverential attachment with which all regarded her became my delight. On the evening previous to her being brought to my home, my mother had said playfully, "I have a pretty present for my victor. Tomorrow he shall have it." And when, on the morrow, she presented Elizabeth to me as her promised gift, I, with childish seriousness, interpreted her words literally, and looked upon Elizabeth as mine. Mine to protect, love, and cherish. No word could express my feelings for her. My more than sister, since till death she was mine only. We grew up together, delighting in one another's company. And yet our natures were so very different. Elizabeth busied herself with poets and gazing in wonder at the high Alps. I was not content simply to look on. It was the secrets of heaven and earth that I desired to learn. I wanted to gaze upon the inner spirit of nature and the mysterious soul of man. It was my temper to avoid a crowd. I preferred one close friendship to a multitude of slight acquaintances, and so I united myself to one of my schoolfellows, Henry Clerval. He was to remain my friend the whole of his life. He was a boy of singular talent and imagination, but we were not alike. Clerval occupied himself with the moral relations of things, the busy stage of life, the virtues of heroes, the actions of men. He wanted to be one of the gallant and adventurous benefactors of the human race. Only Elizabeth could settle our petty disputes and boyish disagreements.
Ah, there you are! What on earth are you doing?
Shh! Ruin everything.
You're always down in this dank cellar. You'll go blind in the dark.
Clerval, will you be quiet?
Not till you tell me what you're up to. Aren't those the candles from the church? Victor!
I am conjuring the spirits of the dead. Demons.
Oh, what rubbish. You'll only frighten yourself stupid.
Oh, you don't understand. No one does. I have spent the last 2 weeks studying ancient authorities. It will work.
Victor! Oh. Henry, are you down there?
Oh, damn. I'll see what you've done. You left the door open. How can the spirits come when the world and his wife are
undone? Victor! Is something wrong?
Oh, Henry's ruined everything.
I have not. Victor is playing at being God, conjuring up ghosts and ghouls.
Oh, yes. You laugh if you want. You'll see.
Victor, don't be so passionate. Your father wants to see you. I've looked for you everywhere.
Oh, I'm sorry. Elizabeth, sorry. Can you forgive me?
Of course.
I was, perhaps, sometimes sullen in my study, a little rough through the ardor of my nature. But Elizabeth was always there to subdue me to a semblance of her own gentleness. She did not criticize my work. Only my father and Clerval poured scorn upon my studies. But I was not to be deterred. I continued to search with the greatest diligence for the elixir of life. What glory would attend the discovery If I could banish disease from the human frame and render man invulnerable to any but a violent death. The turning point came one summer. Henry Clerval had come with us on holiday in the Jura Mountains. We had retired to our house near Bellerive when we witnessed the most violent and terrible thunderstorm.
Look at the rain. It is a final deluge. The world is to be swept away in flood and tempest.
Stay under the porch. You'll get soaked.
Oh, I need to be there. Don't you see? This is nature's power. Unstoppable. Terrifying. Look. Look. An oak tree is completely destroyed. I must see.
Victor, come back!
Nothing left but a stump of blackened charcoal. Such power.
I knew in that moment that it was only a matter of time, perhaps years, but I knew that I was set upon a road of discovery that could not be abandoned. I would harness this power. The time came when I was to be sent to the university. It was resolved that I should go to Ingolstadt to study natural science. But my departure was delayed by two events. Elizabeth caught scarlet fever. Her illness was severe, and she was in the greatest danger. My mother insisted on attending to her, and by great good fortune, Elizabeth was saved. But in the very moment of our rejoicing, my mother sickened with the very same fever. She called Elizabeth and myself to her bedside.
My children, my firmest hopes of future happiness were placed on the prospect of your union. This expectation will now be the consolation of your father. Elizabeth, my love, you must supply my place to the younger children. Alas, I regret that I am taken from you, and happy and beloved as I have been, is it not hard to quit you all? But these are not thoughts befitting me. I will endeavor to resign myself cheerfully to death, and will indulge a hope of meeting you in another world.
And so she died, calmly. For a time I felt the most overwhelming sorrow. My mother was dead. But we still had duties to perform. We must continue our course with the rest and learn to think ourselves fortunate whilst one remains alive whom the spoiler has not seized. My departure for Ingolstadt, which had been deferred, was now again determined upon. I begged my father to let me stay a few weeks longer. I was new to sorrow, but it did not the less alarm me. I was unwilling to quit the sight of those that remained to me, and, above all, I desired to see my sweet Elizabeth in some degree consoled. But the day of departure at length arrived. Clerval came to bid me farewell.
Victor, the great scientist. Oh, Victor, you will discover such things, I know it.
I wish you were coming too.
I have to stay. I have to stay and work in the shop.
Chained to the miserable details of commerce.
Henry is obeying his father. And that is worthy of respect.
Yes, father.
Now, is everything loaded on the coach?
Everything.
Very well. Then we can put off the moment no longer. Say goodbye to Elizabeth.
Oh, Victor, I will miss you.
Elizabeth.
Promise you'll write.
Yes. Yes, of course.
Goodbye.
That's all right. All right, if we do.
Now I shall do such things. The university. I shall be a master of science.
The next morning I delivered my letters of introduction and paid a visit to the principal professors at the university. Chance, or rather my angel of destruction, which now asserted omnipotent sway over me, directed me first to Herr Kremper, professor of natural philosophy.
So, young man, I read that ye are well acquainted with the different branches of science appertaining to natural philosophy. Well then, what authors have you read lately? Be precise in your answer.
I've read all the books on your list, Professor Kremper. And a great deal more.
Oh, I see. A great deal more. Well, and what might this great deal be, precisely?
Cornelius Agrippa, Paracelsus, and Albertus Magnus.
Alchemy and magic. Have you really spent your time studying such nonsense?
I have, sir. And if I may say so, I found it most enlightening.
Indeed? Well, let me tell you something. Every minute, every instant you have wasted on those books is utterly and entirely lost. You have burdened your memory with exploded systems and useless names. Good God, in what desert land have you lived, where no one was kind enough to inform you that these fancies which you have so greedily imbibed are 1,000 years old and as musty as they are ancient? Oh, I little expected in this enlightened and scientific age to find a disciple of Albertus Magnus and Paracelsus. Oh, my dear sir, you must begin your studies entirely anew.
Professor, I must...
I trust you apply yourself to these books with the same diligence as your teachers of dangerous nonsense. You may go. Oh, Herr Frankenstein, I trust you will attend my lectures on natural philosophy. They commence next week at 9 o'clock. Might I also suggest that you attend Professor Waldman? He will deal with chemistry on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Dangerous nonsense. Perhaps, Professor. But I have not retrod the steps of ancient knowledge along the paths of time simply to exchange their dreams of boundless power for realities of little worth. There was a time when the masters of science sought immortality and power. Now science serves only to annihilate those dreams and visions. I will not listen to you. But perhaps Herr Waldman can offer me more. A lecture on chemistry.
The ancient teachers of science promised impossibilities and performed nothing. The modern masters promise very little. They know that metals cannot be transmuted and that the elixir of life is a chimera. But these philosophers, whose hands only seem made to dabble in dirt and eyes to pore over the microscope or the crucible, have indeed performed miracles. They penetrate into the recesses of nature and show how she works in her hiding places. They ascend into the heavens. They have discovered how the blood circulates and the nature of the air we breathe. They have acquired new and almost unlimited power. They can command the thunders of the heavens, mimic the earthquake, and even mock the invisible world with its own shadows.
Yes, so much has been done, but far more will Frankenstein achieve. Treading in the steps already marked, I will pioneer a new way, explore unknown powers, and unfold to the world the deepest mysteries of creation.
That night I lay awake all night. My mind was in turmoil. I knew that I had to dedicate myself to science, body and soul. I had to speak with Professor Waldman. He and he alone would give me the knowledge that I sought. The next day, I knocked on his door. I was received very politely, and I told him of my fascination with the ancient alchemists. Unlike the grotesque Professor Kremper, he did not laugh.
Indeed, Herr Frankenstein, your studies of these ancients has not been entirely in vain. These were the men to whose indefatigable zeal modern philosophers are indebted for the foundations of their knowledge. The labors of men of genius, however misdirected, often turn eventually to the solid advantage of mankind. But you must not neglect the other branches. If your wish is really to become a man of science and not merely a petty experimentalist, I would advise you to apply yourself to every field, including mathematics. Now, sir, if you like, I would be pleased to show you my own laboratory. When you have advanced enough, I may let you use my own instruments.
From this day, natural philosophy, and particularly chemistry, became my sole occupation. I spent every moment working in the laboratory, and my progress was rapid. My ardor astonished both the students and the professors alike. Even Professor Kremper was pleased with my achievements. 2 years passed in this way, during which I did not return home once, but was engaged heart and soul in the pursuit of discovery. Science, the supreme study. In other subjects you go as far as others have gone before you, but there is nothing more to know. But in scientific pursuit, there is continual food for discovery and wonder. One of the phenomena which had particularly attracted my attention was the structure of the human frame. And more than this, I asked myself the fundamental question. How did life begin? I was determined to examine the causes of life. But to probe this great mystery, one must first have recourse to death. Death in all its forms. I had to observe the natural decay and corruption of the human body. My father had taught me not to be afraid of darkness or of any supernatural horror. The churchyard, for me, was no more than the receptacle for dead bodies, which in decay from beauty and strength had become food for the worm. My days and nights were spent in vaults and charnel houses. I saw how the fine form of man was wasted. I beheld the corruption of death invade the cheek of life. I saw the worm inherit the wonders of the eye and of the brain. A pattern began to emerge until, from the midst of darkness and error, a sudden light broke in upon me. The principle of life. It was there. I had discovered it. So brilliant and wondrous, and yet so simple. And I alone should be reserved to discover so astonishing a secret. I see by your eagerness and the wonder in your eyes, my friend, that you expect me to tell you the secret. That cannot be. I will not lead you on, unguarded and ardent as I was then, to your destruction and infallible misery. Learn from me how dangerous is the acquisition of knowledge, and how much happier is the man who believes his native town to be the whole world. Listen to my story, and you may understand. I had the most extraordinary power within my grasp. I could bestow life. How should I use this power? I hesitated. Alone in my laboratory, hidden at the top of the house, I sat and thought.
I have the power to create, to give life. But to what? A man? Or an animal? A human being would be of almost impossible complexity, and yet, if I were to create a man, if I dare to embark on that most glorious task, he will have to be of gigantic stature. Only then can I lace the intricacies of fibers, muscles, and veins. Then it would be possible. It is possible. I must return to the graveyards and charnel houses. I must find the most perfect limbs. Everything must be in proportion. I will go tonight.
Business ago disturbing the dead. I've called the night watch. You'd best come out now.
You don't understand. I'm a scientist. I've come
here... I don't care who you are. You're a grave robber. That's what you are.
Please, I have money. If that's what you want. Any amount, name your price. I just want to be left in peace.
Scientist, eh? Well, that makes a difference. I'm not one to stand in the way of progress. Learning. 200 marks, and I'll see you get as many bodies as you want.
Oh, I'm in your debt, sir. Perhaps you could give me a hand before the night watch comes.
Right, sir.
With your permission, I will be back tomorrow night.
I let you in the front gate then, sir. No need to climb over the wall.
Oh, thank you. I'm very grateful.
Yeah, have you got the money now?
Oh, yes. Yes, here. There will be more tomorrow.
Very good, sir.
Good night.
Good night, sir.
I pursued my task with a passion. Sometimes on the very brink of success, I failed. And yet I clung to the hope which the very next day or hour might bring. I pursued nature in her most secret places with an almost frantic energy. Who shall conceive the horrors of my secret toil as I dabbled among the unhallowed damps of the grave or tortured the living animal? My limbs tremble now and my eyes swim with the remembrance. I seem to have lost all soul or sensation but for this one pursuit. I worked on, day and night, without rest, without stopping, disturbing with profane fingers the tremendous secrets of the human frame. In a solitary chamber at the top of the house, separated from all other apartments by a gallery and a staircase, I kept my filthy workshop of creation. Summer passed. It was the most beautiful season. Never did the fields grow taller wheat or the vines yield a more luxuriant vintage. But my eyes
were insensible to the charms of nature. I worked in darkness and blood. I had forgotten my few good friends, even my family. It was at the beginning of November that my father wrote to me.
I know that while you are pleased with yourself, you will think of us with affection, and we shall hear regularly from you. You must pardon me if I regard any interruption in your correspondence as a proof that your other duties are equally neglected.
Oh, Father,
if only you knew.
I have a new duty, and I am constant. Now, everything is prepared. And tonight there will be such a storm. A storm that will infuse the spark of life into this being. He will be perfect. I have made him perfect. I will break through the bonds of death. I will give life to the dead. And so pour a torrent of light into this dark world. I will first give life to this creature. And then a new species will bless me as their creator and source. Happy and excellent natures will owe their being to me. No father can claim the gratitude of his child so completely as I will deserve theirs. Something wrong. I made it beautiful, but this is a monster. The skin, it is yellow. It does not cover the work of muscles and arteries beneath. The heart is pumping blood, and it is changing. I must escape. I must get out.
Pursue me. I must lock the door. I must sleep. I will get to sleep. It cannot live. So tired.
Frankenstein.
Frankenstein.
Yes? Who's there? Who calls me?
Victor. Victor, my darling.
Oh, Elizabeth. Thank God. Elizabeth. Elizabeth. Mother? No! Don't die! Don't!
Decaying in my hands. Worms!
No! No! Elizabeth! Thank you.
Only a dream.
The shutters. Why are the shutters open? I locked them. I know I locked them.
It's here. In this room.
Don't touch me. Demon. No. Demon, wait.
Monster. I have created a devil. And he reached out to strangle me.
He will not find me. I will escape. Perhaps he is behind me now. No more than a few steps. Like one who on a lonely road doth walk in fear and dread, and having once turned round, walks on and turns no more his head, because he knows a frightful fiend doth close behind him tread. I must keep going. I must find shelter. He will not dare to approach me if I am in the company of other men. What if he is waiting for me? Around this next corner. I must go back. But I dare not.
Sir?
Who's there?
Well, the gate porter, sir. Well, you'll catch your death in this weather, sir. There's a good fire here, if you please.
If I please. Oh, my good man. You have saved my life.
Well, there we are, sir. Come and sit down here. I'll get you a blanket. Another hour and the market will be opening up. You can send for some dry clothes. Well, meantime, we'll get you dry. Isn't it, Frankenstein?
What of it?
Well, don't you remember me, sir? I used to work with the animals at the university. Oh, you've been missed, sir. Been working on something important, have we, sir?
What do you know?
No, I don't know anything, sir.
What have you seen?
Well, nothing. There's no need to get so agitated. I only thought... Here, are you all right, sir? You don't look well.
I am well. Very well. I must go.
Go.
Get out of my way.
Well... Please, Frankenstein, I meant no offence.
Out of my way! He must get out of the town. He knows something. Oh, yes, more than he would say. The dawn. The morning, perhaps. Yes, perhaps. I have been dreaming all this time. I will wake up in my bed and it is all true.
Up so early.
Clever.
My dear Frankenstein, how glad I am to see you. How fortunate that you should be here just as I arrived.
Yes. Yes. Oh, Henry, how glad I am to see you. But what brings you here?
I have a place at the university.
Oh, wonderful.
You may easily believe how great was my difficulty to persuade my father that all necessary knowledge was not comprised in the noble art of bookkeeping. And indeed, I believe, I left him incredulous to the last for his constant answer to my unwearied entreaties was the same as the Dutch schoolmaster and the Vicar of Wakefield. I have 10,000 florins without Greek. I eat heartily without Greek. But his affection for me at length overcame his dislike of learning, and has permitted me to undertake a voyage of discovery to the land of knowledge.
Oh, it gives me the greatest delight to see you. But tell me how you left my father, my brothers, and Elizabeth.
Oh, very well and very happy. Only a little uneasy that they hear from you so seldom. By the by, I mean to lecture you a little from their account myself. But, my dear Frankenstein, I did not before remark how very ill you appear. So thin and pale. You look as if you've been without sleep for several nights.
You have guessed aright. I have been lately so deeply engaged in one occupation that I have not allowed myself sufficient rest, as you see. But I hope, I sincerely hope, that all these employments are at an end, and that I am now free. But let us go to my cottage. You must need a cup of hot coffee. And I need to change. I got caught in the downpour.
What am I saying? To the college? What if the creature I left in my apartment, it might still be there, alive and walking about. Oh, God.
My dear Henry, would you mind waiting here for just a moment? I need to, a sharp moment.
Of course.
Henry must not see it. He must not. Now, I must go in. Not here! Not here! Henry! Come up! Please come up! I was quite afraid that the place was in the most fearful mess, but it seems the servants have cleared up my rubbish. It's all gone! It's all cleared away!
Oh, dear Victor! For God's sake, what is the matter? Don't laugh in that manner, you're ill! What is the cause of all this?
Do not ask me. He can tell. Oh, save me! Save me!
Victor! Oh, my God. He's unconscious. I must get a doctor.
Yeah, the skin. Artery's not covered. Half made up. Oh, demon. Demon! He will destroy me. Must escape.
Victor. Victor. Please, wake up.
Must escape.
Please.
But help me.
Victor!
What did you say? I'm not responsible. Wasn't my fault. I wanted him to be beautiful. Did you hear me?
Victor, please. You're safe. It's me, Henry Clever.
Henry, of course. I'm sorry. I'm not myself.
You've been working too hard, and you've made yourself ill.
Yes. Yes, I've been working. Henry, how can I ever repay you for all that you've done?
You will repay me entirely if you do not upset yourself. And you get well as fast as you can.
Oh, that, my dear friend, is easily done. I'm much better already.
Well, then, since you are in such good spirits, may I speak to you on one particular subject?
And what might that be?
Victor, compose yourself. I will not mention it if it agitates you. But your father and your cousin Elizabeth would be very happy if they received a letter from you.
Oh, is that all, my dear Henry? I will write instantly. How could you suppose that my first thoughts would not fly to my beloved family?
Well, then, before your hand flies to pen and paper, I have a letter here from Elizabeth.
Ah, let me have it.
My dearest cousin, you have been ill, very ill,
And even the constant letters of dear kind Henry are not sufficient to reassure me on your account. I imagine you are attended by some mercenary old nurse who could never guess your wishes, nor minister to them with the care and affection of your own Elizabeth. Get well and return to us. You will find a happy and cheerful home and friends who love you dearly. Since you left us, only one alteration has taken place in our household. Do you remember Justine, our excellent maid? Of course you must. She was a great favorite of yours. Poor Justine had to leave our service as her mother fell ill. And although they had not seen each other for many years, she went immediately to tend her, even though her mother never really loved the poor girl. Your mother was very attached to Justine. She took great pains to educate her, and Justine adored her for it. Indeed, she thought your mother the model of excellence and endeavored to imitate her in every way. Justine's natural mother has now passed away. She was with her till the last. The poor girl has lost all her family now, and foolishly blames herself, as if it were some sin in her which brings such misfortune. You must return soon and speak with her. I know she will listen to your clear counsel. But enough of gloom. There is better news of your little brother, darling William. Oh, I wish you could see him. He's very tall for his age, with sweet laughing eyes, dark eyelashes and curling hair. When he smiles, two little dimples appear on each cheek, which are rosy with health. He has already had one or two little wives, but Louisa Byron is his favorite, a pretty little girl of 10 years of age. I have written myself into better spirits, dear cousin, but my anxiety returns to me as I conclude. Oh, write, dearest Victor. One line, one word will be a blessing to us. Adieu, my cousin. Take care of yourself. And I entreat you, write.
Dear, dear Elizabeth, I will write instantly.
Indeed you must, but I think you need a holiday before you go home.
A holiday? Yes. Oh, yes.
I never had so good a friend. We went walking in the gentle countryside around Ingolstadt. The weather was glorious. Good Clerval. He called forth the better feelings of my heart. My selfish pursuit had cramped and narrowed me. Now his gentleness and affection warmed and opened my senses. I became the same happy creature who a few years ago, loved and beloved by all, had no sorrow or care. We returned to college on a Sunday afternoon. My own spirits were high, and I bounded along with feelings of unbridled joy and hilarity. On my return, I found a letter from my father.
My dear Victor, you have probably waited impatiently for a letter to fix the date of your return to us, and I was tempted to write a few lines merely mentioning the day on which I should expect you. But that would have been a cruel kindness, and I dare not do it. What would have been your surprise, my son, when you expected a happy and glorious welcome, to behold tears and wretchedness? I wish to prepare you for the woeful news, but I know that it is impossible. Even now your eye skims over the page, seeking the words that are to convey horrible tidings. William is dead. That sweet child, whose smiles delighted and warmed my heart, Victor, he is murdered. I will not attempt to console you, but will simply relate the circumstances of this tragedy. Last Thursday, Elizabeth and your two brothers accompanied me on a walk by the lake. The evening was warm and serene, and we prolonged our walk further than usual.
Oh, this is so peaceful. So quiet.
When Victor returns to us, he must come here.
And he will. And you will walk with him alone. You won't want an old man to dock your steps, eh?
Oh, Uncle.
Now, it was a simple statement of fact. I walk very slowly. Oh, it's getting a little chilly. We should be getting back. Where's William and Ernest? Ernest? Ernest! Ah, there he is. Come on, lad. We're going home now. Where's William? What's happened to the boy? Ernest, where's William?
Father, we were playing hide-and-seek. William ran off to hide himself. I looked for him. But, Father, I couldn't find him. I've been trying for the last hour.
I see. Well, perhaps he's gone back to the house. Run back now, see if he's there. If he's not to be found, I want every servant out here with torches. It'll be dark soon, and the boy could have wandered off into the forest. Now, hurry!
Uncle, what if something's...
Now, my dear. Must not be alarmed. Boys are always running off. We'll find him soon enough. And I shall be round with him. I shall tell him what distress he's caused.
But, Uncle...
No, my dear, it must be so. The child must learn to be more responsible. Now, you go back to the house. No doubt you'll find him tired and dirty and in need of a bath. I'll stay here till the servants come. We must find him. Yeah, let Elizabeth get back to the house. I'll find the boy. I'll let him know the distress. Yes, I will. William? William? Where are you? William? William! I can't see anything in this dark. Where are the servants? Damn them. Oh, my God. No. No, no. Please. William. William! Not dead, please. Not dead. Oh. Oh, William!
I'll take you back and we'll warm you by the fire. I'll keep you warm.
Oh, there you are, sir. We couldn't
find... The boy is dead. Elizabeth is not to see him until I've spoken to her. Is that clear?
Uncle, have you...
Oh. Elizabeth! Here, help her. Take her into the parlor. Keep her there. I shall be a few moments.
It is my fault. I have murdered him. I have killed William.
What is this? Oh, my child, it is your grief. Do not distress.
I gave him the locket. The locket of his mother's. He begged me to let him wear it. And now he's been murdered for it. He has been killed for the locket.
Oh, Elizabeth, you must not blame yourself. Come now.
Oh, Uncle.
Oh, Elizabeth, please. Victor, I beg you to return as swiftly as you may. You alone can console Elizabeth. She weeps continually and accuses herself unjustly as the cause of his death. Her words pierce my heart. Come, Victor. Not with brooding thoughts of vengeance against the murderer, but with feelings of peace and gentleness that will heal instead of festering the wounds of our minds. Enter the house of mourning, my friend, but with kindness and affection for those who love you, and not with hatred for your enemies. Your affectionate and afflicted father, Alphonse Frankenstein.
Oh. I must go. I must go home. I must go to Geneva. What has happened? Read the letter. They need me. They need me in Geneva. Oh, God. What man could kill an innocent child? I must ride hard. The darkness will soon obscure the road, and I will not see the ice up there on the pass. I can't even see the mountains. The sky is so dark. Everything is watchful. Silent. I think. I know. Yes, I know what I am to be. I shall be the outcast, the most wretched of men. It will rain soon. I must get to Geneva by daybreak. The gates of the city will be shut. I will be too late. The storm is growing. Seen such lightning, not since that night. It is my brother's requiem. Oh, God! William! This is your funeral. This is your dirge. I must see the place where he died. I must go there. William! Here in the mud and sodden bracken, he died. Strangled. William, you will not be forgotten. Who's there? Who's there, I say? What do you want here? Why have you come? Did you? Are you the murderer?
Demon, I will destroy you. I will.
He is gone. Come back. Come back. I command you. Where are you? You will not escape me!
Ah! There! Scaling the side of Montsalev, crawling up the sheer precipice like a spider. Impossible!
He is the murderer.
And now I see what I've done. I've turned loose into the world, a monster who delights in carnage and in misery. He is my own spirit, my own vampire, let loose from the grave and forced to destroy all that is dear to me. I have given life to a devil.
I will first give life to this creature. And then a new species will bless me as their creator and source. Happy and excellent natures will owe their being to me. No father can claim the gratitude of his child so completely as I will deserve theirs.
I must get to Geneva. I must tell my father. We must pursue the demon. He must be destroyed. I will tell the whole story. We must have guns and... they will think I am a lunatic. I will not be believed. And even if I was indulged and some pursuit was made, who could catch an animal able to leap up mountainsides and live in ice? I must get to Geneva. There is no time to be lost. This fiend will not hurt another soul while I am there to guard them.
It was about 5 in the morning when I entered my father's house. I told the servants not to disturb the family and went into the library to attend their usual hour of rising. At length, my father opened the door.
Victor.
Oh, father!
Oh, my son, thank God. I wish we could have met under different circumstances.
Oh, I will offer what little comfort I...
Elizabeth, she is in great need of your comfort. She accuses herself day and night of being the cause of William's death, but... Well, since the murderer has been discovered...
Discovered? What do you mean? How can that be? It is impossible. One might as well try to overtake the winds or confine a mountain stream with a straw. I saw him. He was free last night.
Oh, Victor, I don't know what you mean. The discovery we have made completes our misery. Huh? No one would believe it at first, and even now Elizabeth will not be convinced. Indeed, who would credit that Justine, our most faithful servant, who was so amiable, so fond of all the family, could suddenly become capable of such an appalling crime?
Justine? Is she accused? But it is a mistake. Everyone knows that. Surely no one believes it.
Well, no one did at first, but I fear that circumstances tell against her, as does her own behavior. But she is to be tried today, and then you will hear all.
Today? But, Father, Justine is innocent. She is innocent.
If she is, God forbid that she should suffer as guilty. She is to be tried today, and I hope, I sincerely hope, that she will be acquitted.
This is madness. Justine is innocent. I am guilty. I created the murderer. I would confess my guilt. Yes. Yes, before this entire court. If I thought I would be believed, that I would be dismissed as no more than a madman. It would not help Justine. Surely they will not find her guilty. Surely. She looks so calm. Will that help or condemn her? The mob think her guilty. They will not listen to reason. They are animals.
Silence in court!
As presiding judge, I must remind those people in the gallery that they must remain silent throughout these proceedings. This is a most sad case, a case which has shocked our whole community. I hope that it may be heard in a spirit of justice and not revenge. Now, Herr Kessler, you may open the case for the prosecution.
Thank you, my lord. The defendant, one Justine Moritz, servant to the Frankenstein household, is accused of the murder of William Frankenstein, a young and innocent child. I propose to call a number of witnesses who will testify to the certain facts that prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that this vile woman is a murderess.
With your permission, my lord, I would like to call Frau Gruber, the dairymaid. Frau Gruber, if you would be so good as to take the witness stand. You have already sworn an oath to tell the truth. I must remind you of that oath.
I always tell the truth, Herr Kessler.
Indeed. Now, Frau Gruber, would you be so good as to tell the court what you know of the accused and her whereabouts on the night of the murder?
Oh, yes. Certainly I will. I saw her right by where the body was found. She did it, no doubt on it.
Frau Gruber, I would be obliged if you would confine your answers to this court to the facts as you remember them, and keep your opinion to yourself.
I will, Your Worship. It was like this, see? I was out early with the rest of the women, getting ready for the early morning milking, when we seen her wandering around with her hair all tangled and her dress all tattered. I asked her what she thought she was doing there. Well, she couldn't give me no answer. She just gave me this queer look and wandered off. That's all we seen of her, till they found the body, just near where she'd been.
Thank you, Frau Gruber. That will be all. I would now like to call Herr Schmidt. He is the butler at the Frankenstein's Country Lodge. Herr Schmidt, if you would be so good as to take the stand. Now, could you tell us, in your own words, what happened next?
I'd like to say Justine is a good girl, and I don't know why she done it. If she done it, I...
Just stick to the facts, Herr Schmidt. The facts. What did the accused do when she saw the body of the deceased?
Well, she just broke down. She had to be carried to her bed. She was sick and thrashed her arms about.
Would you say this was the behavior of a person in their right mind?
She was upset. We all were.
But, Herr Schmidt, did you or any of your staff fall to the ground in violent hysterics?
No, Your Honor.
I would submit, my lord, that this violent reaction to the sight of the body was born out of her guilt and horror at the crime she had so recently committed. Now, Herr Schmidt, would you tell the court what you found on the accused on the night of the murder?
Well, I found...
Please speak up, Herr Schmidt. His lordship would like to hear what you have to say.
I found the locket that was around the neck of the little boy.
Murderer, hanger! Don't deserve to live.
My lord, I have the locket here. Exhibit 1. I now wish to call Elizabeth Frankenstein to the stand. Madam, I know how painful this must be for you, but if you would indulge me for a few moments, I must ask you just one question. Do you see this locket?
Yes.
Can you tell the court, is this your locket, the one that you gave poor little William on the day before he was so brutally murdered?
Yes.
Thank you, madam. You may step down. I now call on the accused, Justine Moritz, to make her statement. This is your only opportunity to address this court. Do you understand?
Yes, sir. I do not know how I come to be accused of so terrible a crime against a child that I have loved since he was born. God knows how entirely I am innocent. I cannot pretend that my protestations should acquit me. I rest my innocence on a plain and simple explanation of the facts. On the night, that night, I was spending an evening with my aunt in Shen. Madame had given me permission to go. About 9 o'clock, I don't remember exactly. I left my aunt and met a man on the road. He asked me if I'd seen anything of the child who was lost. He told me it was Herr Frankenstein's boy. Well, I didn't know what to do. I was so worried for William. I spent hours looking for him, crying out his name. But I couldn't find him. It grew very late. I missed the city gates, and so I had to shelter in a barn. I didn't sleep. I thought William might pass by. Perhaps I did sleep for a few minutes. I remember something moved near my head. A rat, perhaps, or... But I got up and started to look for William again.
I see. You seem to remember things in considerable detail. And perhaps you would like to tell the court how it is that on the night of the murder, you could give no explanation whatsoever to the milkmaids who met you skulking round the barn.
I was so tired, Your Worship. I had had no sleep. I hardly knew where I was.
How convenient. You hardly knew where you were, but you happened to be within yards of the very place where the body was found.
I had no idea where the body was. How could I?
Indeed, how could you? Unless you were in fact the murderer. Let me pass on to the next important question, a fact which weighs very heavily in this case. Can you deny that the locket which the poor child wore round his neck was found a few days later in your clothing?
I cannot, if you say so. But I do not know how it came to be there.
Once again, how convenient.
I know how heavily this one circumstance weighs against me, but I have no power of explaining it. How did it come to be in my pocket? I do not know. Someone must have put it there.
Indeed. And who do you think could have done such a thing?
I do not know. Perhaps the murderer placed it there on purpose. Perhaps. And yet I know of no time when that could have been done.
So it is all idle conjecture. I have one final question. Why do you think the murderer, having killed in order to steal the locket, why should he or she decide to leave it behind?
I cannot say.
I rest my case, my lord.
Prisoner at the bar, have you any final statement before we adjourn to consider my verdict?
I commit my cause to justice. I see no room for hope. I beg permission to have a few witnesses examined concerning my character. If their words cannot outweigh what has been said, then I am to be condemned. But I am innocent, and I would pledge my salvation on my innocence.
Very well. Is there any within this court who will stand as a character witness for the accused? Will no one stand?
I am the cousin of the unhappy child who was murdered. Or rather, his sister, for I was brought up by his natural parents ever since and even long before he was born. It may be judged indecent in me to come forward on this occasion. But when I see a fellow creature about to die through the cowardice of her pretended friends, I wish to be allowed to speak so that I may say what I know of her character. I am well acquainted with the accused. I have lived in the same house with her for nearly 7 years. During all that time, she seemed to me the most amiable and benevolent of all human creatures. She nursed Madame Frankenstein in her last illness with the greatest affection and care. She was warmly attached to the child who is now dead and acted towards him as the most loving mother. For my own part, I do not hesitate to say, notwithstanding all the evidence produced against her, I believe and rely on her perfect innocence. She had no temptation for such an action. As to the bauble on which the chief proof rests, if she had earnestly desired it, I should have willingly given it to her. So much do I esteem and value her.
Oh, such a lady. Why should she suffer for a murderess?
Hang her.
She's as guilty as hell.
Hang her.
Hang her.
She should be hanged.
Silence, or I will clear the court. The court will adjourn to consider its verdict.
She is innocent. I know it. And yet they will condemn her. She's as good as dead. And I am the source and origin of... I created the murderer. I! Her virtue shines in such adversity. She cannot know my pain. She is sustained by innocence. I am damned by guilt. Guilt! I must get out of here. I must leave this room.
I passed the night in agony. In the morning, I went to the court. My lips and throat were dry. I dared not ask the fatal question.
Excuse me, I am...
I know who you are, sir. It's Herr Frankenstein, isn't it? You wish to know the verdict. Guilty. She is to be hanged tomorrow. Oh, now, sir, compose yourself. Would you like to sit down?
No. No, thank you.
She confessed, you know. A full confession. Evidence was hardly required in so glaring a case. But I was glad of the confession. None of our judges like to condemn a criminal upon circumstantial evidence, be it ever so decisive. Now, sir, if there's nothing else, I must return to the court. We have to clear the litter in the gallery. People leave such a mess.
Confession? How can she confess? I know the murderer. It was the creature. The thing I put together. But what if I'm wrong? What if Justine... Could she be such a monster?
I must tell Elizabeth. She must know. Elizabeth, please sit down. I will not spare you. The verdict is guilty.
How?
Elizabeth, please. Listen. Justine has confessed. She has confessed to the crime.
No. No, it is not possible. I love Justine. I loved her as a sister. I will see her. I must see her. This cannot be true.
Elizabeth.
Father. Have you heard Justine has confessed?
Yes, and she is to pay the price. We must all pray for her.
I will go to her. I must speak with her. If she is guilty, I must know why she did it. I will go. Victor, you must come with me.
What? Oh, yes, of course. Yes, I will come.
Elizabeth, my child, I beg you, this is futile. You will only upset yourself.
I must be the judge of that. Victor, we must go at once.
She told me about this visit. You should talk to the governor. I don't know as
how much do you want?
Offering a bribe, eh?
It's not a bribe. A fee for your cooperation.
Well, you've got 10 minutes and that's all.
Justine, why did you... I believed in your innocence.
And do you believe I am so wicked? Have you joined with my enemies? Have you?
No. I believed you guiltless. No shred of evidence and circumstance could convince me. But you have confessed.
I did confess. But I confessed a lie. I confessed so that I could obtain absolution. And now that lie is worse than all my sins. Ever since I was condemned, the priest has been here every hour, threatening me with hell and damnation if I did not confess. Every hour until I almost began to believe I was the monster he said I was.
I will proclaim your innocence. You shall not die. You shall not.
I do not fear to die. God takes away my weakness and gives me courage to endure the worst.
The worst? How can she know what is the worst?
She will pass the awful boundary between life and death and be at peace. But I will be left. There is no respite for me. My creation is the murderer, and he murders to hurt me. I am the one who should hang. I must save her. Only I can do it. I must confess. I will confess. I will go in her place. I will see the judge tonight.
What the hell is it? Who knocks at this infernal hour?
Frankenstein! Victor Frankenstein! I must speak with you. I must...
What?
Justine Moritz is innocent. She did not kill my brother. If you will listen... Oh, I can tell you...
She is condemned, sir. And that is the end of the matter. Unless you have some extraordinary new evidence of her innocence, I cannot help you.
I do. I have...
Yes?
I know she is innocent.
What do you know?
I know. I just know.
Good night, sir. I'll listen to no more of your ranting.
But...
One more word, and I will call the watch. Good night.
Then I can do no more. Justine dies tomorrow.
There was nothing more I could have done. The judge refused to believe me. I told him that I knew the identity of the murderer. But he would not listen. And Justine is dead. At least she is at rest. Whilst I am still alive to carry the weight of despair. Alone. Entirely and utterly alone. Like some evil spirit condemned to wander the earth forever. But all I wanted, all I ever worked for, was the benefit of all mankind. My heart overflowed with kindness, virtue. It is still there. He has done this. He has stolen my soul. I am in hell. Oh, Father, no. Don't talk to me. He's coming towards me. He's smiling. Go away. I cannot look you in the face. I must remain alone. In dark, death-like solitude.
Victor. Victor, listen to me. Do you think that I do not suffer also? No one could love a child more than I loved your brother. But is it not a duty to the survivors that we should refrain from adding to their unhappiness by immoderate grief? It is also a duty to yourself. For excessive sorrow prevents enjoyment or useful industry, without which no man is fit for society.
Father, if you will excuse me, I have business to attend to.
Victor.
I could not bear the company of other human beings. Thankfully, we retired to our house in Bellerive in the autumn. This allowed me more freedom to be alone. Often, after the rest of the family had gone to bed, I took a boat and rowed into the middle of the lake. I lay in the bottom of the boat, allowing it to drift aimlessly. I sank deeper into my own miserable reflections.
There is no way out. No escape. I do not deserve to live. I am my own judge and jury. The dark, cold waters will close over my head and end my misery. It will be over. For me, yes. It would be over for me. But what about those I leave? Leave to the fiend. He would not stop. He would go on. I cannot abandon them. And there will be more death unless I can prevent it. Danger, as long as anything I love remains alive.
Our house was the house of mourning. My father's health was deeply shaken by the horror of William's death. Elizabeth was sad and despondent and took no delight in anything.
Elizabeth, is there anything...
It was unjust, Victor. Since Justine was killed, I cannot see the world as it used to be.
Oh, Elizabeth!
I used to think that injustice, vice, and monstrous evil were things confined to books and tales of ancient days. But now misery has come home, and men appear to me as monsters thirsting for each other's blood. If Justine had murdered little William for a locket, then she would indeed have been the most depraved of human creatures. But she was innocent. I know, I feel she was innocent. And you are of the same opinion, and that confirms me. Oh, Victor, when falsehood, lies, can look so much like the truth, who can be assured of happiness?
If anyone can be happy, my dearest Elizabeth, it is you. You are held in such high regard by...
I feel as if I were walking on the edge of a precipice, towards which thousands are crowding and trying to plunge me into the abyss. William and Justine were assassinated, and the murderer escapes. He walks about the world free and perhaps respected. But even if I were condemned to suffer on the scaffold for the same crimes, I would not change places with such a wretch. Victor? Victor, please, what is the matter?
I am well, Elizabeth. I just wish I could make you happy. That's all.
Oh, Victor.
I shall never let anyone hurt you. He shall not. My dearest Elizabeth, I'm going on a short trip, a holiday into the mountains. I shall be gone a few days only. I came to tell you. I am to leave immediately. There is a carriage waiting for me. I must go now. I shall only be gone a few days. Goodbye.
Victor?
Goodbye, Elizabeth.
What did you mean? Who will hurt me? Victor!
I was free. Free to wander in the mountains and to forget my misery. I saw no one, and as I penetrated deeper into the solitary wilderness, the weight upon my spirit was lifted. Sheer cliffs of solid rock rose above my head. Thunderous streams poured pure, ice-cold water from clefts in the granite hundreds of feet above my head. Such things spoke of a mighty power, omnipotent. And as I wandered in this sublime and wild creation, I ceased to fear any being less almighty than that which had created these elements. Surely a race of mighty beings must inhabit such a world. My heart, which before was sorrowful, now swelled with something almost like joy. I did say those words. I looked up to heaven and cried aloud. But in that very moment, I suddenly beheld the figure of a man. He was at some distance, but moving towards me with superhuman speed. He bounded over great crevices in the ice as if they were no more than cracks in the pavement. He was at least 8 feet in height. It was my creation.
A faintness seized me, and I nearly fell to the ground. My mind was in a chaos. I bit my tongue hard to stop myself sliding into unconsciousness. I could see him clearly now, no more than 10 yards from me. His face was twisted in anguish and hatred. He was breathing hard. I was filled with the most uncontrollable rage and detestation.
So, you dare to approach me, demon? Do you not fear the fierce vengeance I shall... You shall pay for the deaths of your victims. I shall trample you into the dust.
I expected this reception. All men hate the wretched. How then must I be hated, who am miserable beyond all living things? I am bound to only one other living creature. You.
Yes.
Yet you, my creator, detest and spurn me. Me, your creature, to whom you are bound by ties only death can unloose. You wish me dead, and yet you gave me life. Do your duty towards me, and I will do mine towards mankind and to you. If you will listen to my plea, I will leave them and you at peace. But if you refuse, I will glut the maw of death with the blood of your remaining friends.
Monster! Devil! You reproach me with your creation. Very well. Come on, let me snuff out that spark of life which I so negligently bestowed. I will destroy you!
Be calm, Frankenstein. I beg you, hear me. I will not be destroyed at your whim. Life, though it is only an accumulation of misery, is dear to me now. And I will defend it. I could snap your bones like twigs if you were but to touch me. You made me strong. Stronger than the greatest man. That you cannot take away. But I will not kill you. I am your creature. I will be mild and docile to my natural lord. If... you will fulfill your duty towards me. Oh, Frankenstein, do not be just to every other creature and trample upon me alone. You owe me love. I am your creature, your Adam. But you make me your fallen angel. Everywhere I see love, from which I alone am excluded. I was good. Misery made me a fiend. Make me happy, and I shall again be virtuous.
I will not hear you. We are enemies.
How can I move you? Frankenstein. I was good. My soul was filled with love. But now I am alone. Miserably alone. If you, my creator, abhor me, what can I hope from other men who owe me nothing? I have lived alone in caves of ice and on the barren rock, far from the habitation of men. I do not choose this place. I have been driven by men to live in solitude. If they could catch me, they would kill me. They have taught me how to hate.
And if I am miserable, then they shall share in that misery. Yet it is in your power to restore me, and so deliver mankind from an evil so great that not only you and your family, but thousands of others shall be swallowed up in the whirlwinds of my rage.
No. No.
Listen to my story. When you have heard, then abandon me or help me as you shall judge. But hear me. The guilty are allowed by human laws, bloody as they are, to speak in their own defense. I do not ask you to spare me, but to listen. And then, if you can, or if you will, destroy the work of your own hands.
No. No! Damn you! You have made me wretched. I cannot think of any justice for you. Get out of my sight!
You may shut your eyes, but you may still listen. Hear my tale. It is long and strange. Come with me. This place is too open, too cold for you. There is a hut nearby. There you may rest in comfort. I have built a fire. You may warm yourself. Come! Come! When I first awoke, everything was indistinct. Out of silence, I suddenly heard sounds. Terrible crashes and cries. I saw dim shapes moving in front of my eyes. Nothing was as it had been. I remember moving from a warm, dark space into cold and wet. Then light and heat. Terrible light pressed upon my eyes, blinding me. I hid from the light, and again it became dark. But out of the dark, I saw, rising above the great shapes that surrounded me, a round ball of gentle light. This light comforted me, and I followed it through the darkness. But I could not touch it. And when the darkness faded, and the greater light returned, I heard sweet sounds in the air, flying above my head. I tried to sing the same notes, but I could not. The light came and went, and it grew colder. I woke up covered in cold white powder, which covered everything. I shook with the cold and cried aloud. The berries and roots that I had eaten now were buried, and hunger gnawed at my stomach. I chewed the bark of trees to live and sucked at ice for water. As I walked, I heard a new sound. I heard voices coming from a large wooden shack behind some trees.
What do you mean? If I'm out chopping wood all day, I expect it to be ready when I get back.
Oh, you do, do you?
Yes!
Well, you just have to wait. The chicken's not done yet.
What?
You heard me.
I've told you before. Didn't I say to you, if my food's not on the table when I get home, I'd...
What? You'd what?
I pressed my ear close to the wall to hear these wonderful sounds. I would go in to see these creatures.
You know. Don't you go provoking me. You know what I'm like when I'm provoked.
Oh, yes. Come on, then. on? No need to take on like that. I didn't. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Don't come in here. Don't. Don't touch me.
They left me their food, and I was grateful. I sat and ate and warmed myself by the fire. The next day, the warm sun shone brightly on the snow, and I determined to continue my travels. At sunset, I arrived at a village. Such comfort! Warm lights glowed in the windows, and I could hear laughter in the quiet lanes. I resolved to see the inhabitants. I stared through the window of one cottage, and seeing three or four of the same creatures I had seen in the wood, I resolved to step through the door.
What? Oh, my God! George!
That's far enough. Don't you come a step nearer. Tom, I'm not going to say that. Get out the back door and fetch every person you can find. There! Now, run!
Where is it? Over here!
It kind of got far. It was 10 feet tall.
Over here. There he is. There. There. Don't get too close.
Well, give me that stone.
He's getting away. Stop him.
So this was the true spirit of these creatures. Violence and hatred. I had done them no harm. I ran, bruised and bleeding, from the village. When the sun rose, I found a single cottage in a clearing in the forest. I would have moved on, afraid of more hurt, but I was tired and in need of rest. On one side of the cottage, there was a small wooden hovel leaning against the wall. I crawled into this sanctuary and fell into a sleep. After hours, I awoke. Again, I heard the voice of a man. I watched him in fear, but he seemed to be alone, and he did not come near my hiding place. I watched all day. It seemed that there were three people in the cottage: a young girl, the man I had seen, and a very old man who spent all day sitting in his chair. I found I could observe him from a chink in the wall of the cottage, and I could hear every sound they made. And although I could not understand their words, they seemed very sad.
There is nothing left. We've eaten the last of the salted meat.
Then we must give what we have to Father.
I may be blind, my dearest child, but I am not yet deaf. We will share what food there is between us, and we must pray for better times to come.
Yes, Father.
Damn this poverty. If I could only regain our fortune, I would go
out. But you can't. Not this minute, at any rate. So accept what is. Now, come on, sit down. Have you forgotten how rich we are in one another's company? You cannot buy love. Here. Let us share this bread, and I shall play to you.
The sound was unlike anything I had ever heard, sweeter than the nightingale. And as the old man played, the young girl began to cry. She looked up into the old man's face with such love, And I was overwhelmed by pain and pleasure all at once. I could not bear these feelings, and I turned away. The days wore on, and I spent my time watching, listening, and learning. I found that each day I understood a little more. I also saw that their life was one of abject poverty. Often I would see the young cottagers weeping. I then thought, if such lovely creatures were miserable, it was less strange that I, an imperfect and solitary being, should be wretched. I resolved to help these excellent creatures in whatever way I could. I noticed that the youth spent a great part of each day gathering firewood. I resolved I would do this task, and that night chopped down a forest of firewood and piled it high outside the cottage door. They would find it the next morning.
Felix? Felix, the door won't open. I can't get it open.
Oh, let me. Well, perhaps if you gave me a hand.
Felix, look. Wood. A whole mountain of firewood. Chopped and stacked. How did it get here?
Well, whoever did it has done us a good turn and saved me a lot of work. So why worry how it got here? Come on, let's get the door open and light the fire.
I went on gathering logs at night, and they spoke of me as their good spirit, their loving spirit. One night, I was returning to the cottage with a bundle of kindling, and I stumbled. I fell to the ground into a muddy pool. When the water had settled, glistening in the light of the moon, I saw the most horrible form. I started back in terror. It disappeared. I moved slowly back to the edge of the pool, and again the monster reappeared. It was in that moment that I saw what I was. Deformed, abhorrent, terrifying. I wept bitter tears, howling at the moon. My companions, the gentle creatures who I lived to serve, would run. They would run like all the others, in fear and loathing. I crawled back into the shadows of my hovel and shook with tears of rage and despair. Yet when the morning came, and I heard the birds sing and felt the warm sun upon my back, I knew that I could reveal myself. They would not reject me, one who had so diligently served them in the coldest winter, in the darkest nights. I had but to master their language, and to choose the right moment, and all would be well. I continued to learn. Every conversation of the cottagers opened new wonders to me. I heard of the division of property, of immense wealth and squalid poverty, of rank, descent, and of noble blood. Family. These words turned my thoughts towards myself. Where was my family? My father and mother? What was I? Of my creation and my creator, I was absolutely ignorant. But I knew that I possessed no money, no friends, no kind of property. I was hideously deformed. I was not even of the same nature as man. I looked around. I saw none like me. Was I a monster? An aberration from which all men fled? How strange are thoughts. They cling to the mind like lichen on a rock. They cannot be shaken off. Who was I? What was I? Again and again, The question beat upon my brain until I thought I would go mad. Who am I? Who am I? Who am I? And my sorrow only increased with my knowledge. One night, whilst I was collecting wood, I happened upon a leather bag lying on the path. Inside was a book. I determined that I would learn to decipher the marks I found upon the page, and after months of constant struggle, I began to read. The book was called Paradise Lost. At first, I read haltingly, but with time, my understanding became a flood. This history of an omnipotent God warring against his creatures, inspired me with the greatest wonder. And I saw that I was like Adam, connected by no link to any other being in existence. But Adam had come forth from the hands of God. He had been made in God's image, perfect, beautiful, complete. He was allowed to speak and learn from other beings of a superior nature. But I was wretched, helpless, and alone. A fitter emblem of my state was Satan. For often, when I saw the bliss of my protectors, the bitter gall of envy rose within me. But nothing that I read in this great book, no pain or wretched loneliness, could prepare me for what was yet to come. It was near sunset. I put my book aside to think on what I had read that day. I lay down and shut my eyes for a moment, closed my eyes so that I might see with the mind's eye the great battle fought in heaven. When I remembered some papers that I had found in the pocket of my clothes, at first I had neglected them, but now I was able to read. I decided to decipher them. Perhaps I would learn something of benefit. I took the papers from my pocket, and I began to read your words, the record of my creation. In a solitary chamber at the top of the house, I have kept my filthy workshop of creation. A year has passed in almost constant toil. Now I see an end to my task. November the 7th, all is ready. I have collected the instruments of life around me. Tonight I will infuse the spark of life into this lifeless thing that lies at my feet. The storm is approaching. It cannot be long. Soon, this filthy patchwork of dead matter will take on life. Monster! Loathsome monster! Why did he make me? Why? Why? God made man beautiful after his own image. I am filthy. Filthy! Loathsome monster! I read your words. I read them. I am a monster.
You created me. Loathsome. Wretched. Even Satan had companions. Oh, yes. Devils to admire and to encourage him. But I am solitary and abhorred. You have wronged me. Listen to my story, and you will see how you have wronged me. I resolved, rather than let despair destroy me in this moment, I would speak to the gentle people who for so long had been the object of my love. I had done them so much good, they could not spurn me. I would speak with them. I knew that I could not simply appear. They would be afraid of so hideous a creature. I would first speak to the old man. As he was blind, he would not fear to speak with me. One morning, I saw that the old man was alone. This was the moment. My heart beat quick. All was silent in the cottage. I got up, but could not move. Fear paralyzed me. I sank to the ground. I tried again, and this time moved towards the cottage door. Keep going. I will be welcome. I will be saved. I will be loved. They cannot deny me. I have done so much. Now, just knock. Just knock on the door.
Who is there?
A traveller in want of a little rest.
Oh, come in. Come in.
I would be grateful if you would allow me to remain a few minutes to warm myself by the fire.
Oh, you are most welcome. You may share whatever is here. But I fear I may not be of much help. I am blind, and my children are not at home, and there's not much food in the house.
Do not trouble yourself, my kind host. I have food. It is warmth and rest that I need.
Have you a long journey ahead?
No. I hope that my journey is nearly at an end. I am going to meet some friends who I sincerely love. I have hopes that they may offer me some protection.
Oh, I'm sure.
These people have never seen me. They know little of me. I am full of fears, for if I fail there, I am an outcast in the world forever.
Do not despair. To be friendless is to be indeed unfortunate, but the hearts of men, if not tainted by prejudice or self-interest, are full of love. Therefore, do not despair.
They are kind. They are the most excellent creatures in the world. But unfortunately, they are prejudiced against me. My life so far has been harmless. I have done some good. Where they ought to see a feeling and a kind friend, they only behold a detestable monster.
That is indeed unfortunate, but if you really are blameless, surely you'll be able to convince them of your virtue.
I'm about to undertake that task. It is on that account that I feel so many overwhelming terrors. Yet I am determined to show my friends how much I love them.
Where do these friends live?
Near this spot.
If you will tell me your story, the whole story, I may be of some use in undeceiving them. I am blind and cannot judge of your features, but there is something in your words which persuades me that you are sincere.
Oh, excellent man. I thank you and accept your generous offer.
May I know the names of your friends?
The names?
Father, we're back. We've got... What the...
Now is the time. Save me. You and your family are the friends I seek. Do not desert me!
Oh, great God, who are you?
Monster! Oh. Get away from my father!
What is it?
Cursed, cursed creator. Why did I live? Why? I ran from the cottage. Felix had beaten my head till the blood flowed over my eyes. I could have torn him limb from limb. I ran through the forest, tearing and smashing my way through, howling in my anguish. I bore a hell within me. At night, I returned to the cottage. It was empty. They had abandoned me. I lit a dry branch. Fire. Fire. I destroyed the cottage, the garden, everything. The wind blew the flames into a furnace, and everything was destroyed. Red, blood, red flames. I knew then that there was only one man. One man in all the world who could not turn me away. I resolved I would find you, my creator. I remembered from your papers that you lived in a place called Geneva. I would find this place. I walked for days, weeks, months, never stopping. My heart hung like a stone within me. I came to a river. I was about to swim across when I saw a young girl skipping on the bank. Suddenly, she fell into the swift water. She screamed. I threw myself into the water to help her. I dragged the creature from the river and laid her gently on the bank. She was senseless, but not dead. I rubbed her hands. I had saved her. Again, I was moved by pity. Suddenly, a man appeared. He had a gun. He shouted and fired. I fell back. He grabbed the girl and ran. Ingratitude. Pain. I writhed in pain. The bullet had shattered bone and flesh. Blood seeped into my wet clothes and stained the ground dark red. Hatred. Hatred for man. All mankind. No love. Nothing. Empty. For weeks, I lay in freezing cold, shaking with fever and intense pain. And my hatred grew. I would be revenged on man. The wound closed, and I dragged my body on to seek you. I felt you in the night. I could feel your fear, your loathing. One day, I knew that I was close to you. Somehow, you were there in the wood. But I did not find my creator. Instead, I found a little boy. A child. As I gazed on him, playing, innocent and unperturbed, I was seized by an idea. Here was a creature, unprejudiced and unafraid. He would not recoil from my deformity. If I could take him and educate him as my companion, I need not be alone. I came towards him. I smiled.
Child, what is the meaning of this? I will not hurt you. Listen to me.
Let me go, monster! You want to eat me and tear me to pieces? You're an ogre. Let me go or I will tell my papa.
Boy, you will never see your father again. You will come with me.
Let me go. My papa is a very important man. Herr Frankenstein. He will punish you. You dare not keep me.
Frankenstein. My enemy. You belong to him. Then you will be the instrument of my revenge. You shall be my first victim.
No. No!
The child struggled. I only wished to silence him. Perhaps he could be made to understand. But within a moment, he lay dead at my feet. I was in the grip of a hellish madness. I cried out, "I too can create desolation. My enemy is not invulnerable. This death will carry despair to him, and a thousand other miseries shall torment and destroy him." As I fixed my eyes on the child, I saw something glittering at his throat. It was a locket. I took it and ran from the body. I ran till I came to a barn. I hoped to rest, but found a woman sleeping on the straw. My mind clouded with darkness. Here, I thought, is one of those creatures whose smiles are bestowed on all but me. I bent over her and whispered, "Awake, fairest. Thy lover is near. He who would give his life for one look of affection." She stirred. I was gripped with fear. What if she should see me? What if I were caught? But she did not wake. And it was then that I thought, I will not suffer for the murder. She will pay the price. I bent down and hid the locket in her clothing. I knew you were close. I knew you would try to seek me out. I have waited for you in these mountains. And now you have heard my story. Now you must do as I ask you. We may not part until you have agreed to comply with my desire. I am alone and miserable. Man will not associate with me, but one as deformed and horrible as myself would not deny herself to me. I want a woman, the same species, the same deformity. This being you must create. You alone can do this. I demand it as my right.
Never. I do refuse it. And no torture can ever extort consent from me.
You are wrong. I will not threaten. I want to reason with you. I am malicious because I am miserable. You, my creator, would tear me to pieces and triumph. Remember that, and tell me why I should pity man more than he pities me. And yet, if I could find one person who would love me, for that one creature's sake, I would make peace with the whole world. I would return their love 100-fold. But if I cannot inspire love, I will cause fear, and chiefly in you. I will work to your destruction, nor finish until I desolate your heart, so that you shall curse the hour of your birth. But I intended to reason. This passion will only turn you from me. What I ask of you is reasonable and moderate. I demand a creature of another sex, but as hideous as myself. On that account, we shall be attached to one another. Oh, my creator, make me happy. Do not deny my request.
There is some justice in its argument. And am I not his maker?
If you consent, neither you nor any other human being shall ever see us again.
I see. But how can you, who long for the love of man, remain in exile? You would return, and again meet with detestation. You would return to evil, and this time you would have a companion.
Why? Why do you harden yourself to my request? I swear to you that I would flee the sight of man, and with my companion I will know love. My life will flow quietly away, and in my dying moments I shall not curse my maker.
Perhaps I am unjust. Perhaps this is the only way. He has moved my pity, and it would be difficult to resist such a creature capable of such strength. I will agree.
I consent to your request, on your solemn oath that you will leave Europe forever the moment I have delivered a female into your hands.
I swear by the sun and the blue sky of heaven, and by the fire of love that burns in my heart. Now, go. I shall watch your labors. I shall appear when you have completed your task.
He left me. I saw him descend the mountain with the speed of an eagle, and soon he was lost in the undulations of snow and ice. What did I say? How could I have agreed to such a thing? My head swam. I could not stand. The sun had set, and the sky was full of cold stars. I stumbled back to the path. I walked all night, and by dawn I arrived home. I knew that I had no choice but to commence my hated task immediately. I found that I could not compose a female without again devoting myself to laborious and profound study. I had heard of some recent discoveries made by some English scientists, and these were vital to the success of my latest creation. I determined to go to England. For weeks, I walked as if in a dream. Before I was ready to depart, my father took me aside.
Victor, I've noted a melancholy look in your face. You've carried it around for weeks, and yet there's no reason that I can fathom. Except one, Victor. Victor, may I speak plainly?
Father?
Oh, I must confess, my son, that I've always looked forward to a time when you and Elizabeth might be man and wife. Oh, you were attached to each other from the earliest days. And I had hoped that this childish love might blossom into... well, into marriage. Victor, it occurs to me that my expectation might be the source of your sadness. For you may have met another whom you love. Is this a...
My dear father, be assured. I love my cousin and no other. I've never thought of another as my future bride.
Victor, you've made me so very happy. And so I'd like to suggest, if it's not a little premature, that perhaps you could marry very soon. Well, I say this only because such a happy event would blow away all our recent suffering. I will, of course, understand should you wish to delay.
Oh, God! How can I marry Elizabeth when I'm bound to create a mate for that creature? I cannot. I must not. Once I have fulfilled my promise, then I can be happy. Father, nothing would give me greater pleasure. I would only wish for a short delay. I have resolved to take a holiday to England. There are some friends from the university who now reside there. I have long intended to...
Well, of course, my dear fellow, a holiday. What a splendid idea. Well, that gives me time to bustle and prepare for the wedding on your return. Excellent. Well, I will tell Elizabeth. She will help you to prepare your things.
Oh, Victor. I shall miss you terribly. But I know a holiday will do you the world of good. I have also prepared a little surprise for you.
Surprise?
Yes. I'm sure you'll need a companion to accompany you on the long and arduous journey. And so I have asked Clerval if he would go with you and look after you.
What?
Henry Clerval. He was so happy when I suggested it to him.
I see.
Well.
No, no. I need no one to come with me. I need to be absolutely alone.
He says he can join you in Strasbourg. Victor, I thought you would be pleased.
A tremendous idea. My best friend, I haven't seen him for months. A lovely idea.
After some days spent in listless indolence, I travelled to Strasbourg, where I waited 2 days for Clerval. He came. The contrast between us could not have been more marked. He was alive to every new scene, every sunset, every new colour in the sky.
This is what it is to live. Look, just look at that mountain, magnificent. Do you see the way the light shimmers on the new snow? God's own handiwork.
I was forced to listen to his endless eulogies on every rainbow, every stream. We had agreed to descend the Rhine in a boat from Strasbourg to Rotterdam, and from there we could take a boat to London. Every step was made more painful by Clerval's damnable cheerfulness.
I feel I am in fairyland. Sure. You may scoff, but it's true. Have you ever seen such sights, such beauty? Look at that castle, look! Oh, that precipice. And there, that island, almost concealed amongst the foliage of those lovely trees. And there, those labourers coming out from among their vines. Oh, and look! Look at that pretty village hidden in the gorge. Oh, Frankenstein! Surely the spirit that inhabits this wonderful place lives in total harmony with man.
Our journey wore on. After some weeks, we arrived in Rotterdam and thence to London. Here, at last, I was able to say farewell to Clerval. Still, the very best of men. But he could have no part in my dark purposes, or the fate that still pursued me.
I had chosen a remote island in Scotland to be the place where I would assemble the female creature. Remote and inaccessible. I would not be disturbed. Only a few crofters lived on the island, and they did not come near me. I worked day and night to complete my task. During my first experiments, a kind of enthusiastic frenzy blinded me to the horror of my employment. But as the creature took shape, I went to the work in cold blood, sickened by what I was about to do. The last day came. The body was complete. I grew restless and nervous. On this day, the creature would come to claim his mate. I sat, waiting, my eyes fixed to the ground, fearing to raise them, lest I should see him. The last element to add to the body that lay before me were the eyes, the windows of the soul. I paused. My mind recalled the dreadful moment 3 years before when I had created a fiend. I was about to form another being.
Ready. Now the eyes. And then... she will live. One spark. And life will begin. But what will she be? What if she were to become 10,000 times more malignant than her mate? Will she delight in murder for its own sake? He has sworn to quit the sight of men. She has not. She might refuse to comply with the compact made before her creation. They might even live to hate each other. No, I cannot do it. I must not!
Frankenstein! Frankenstein, I have come to claim my mate. You are nearly ready.
No,
No! It shall never be! I will destroy it!
No!
Now!
No! Why have you destroyed the work of your hands? Why?
You'll never create another like yourself. Deformed and evil.
I reasoned with you. You have betrayed me. Now you will truly know what it is to be miserable. You are my creator. But now, I shall be your master.
Oh, you have no power over me. I will not set loose another demon to plague man. No!
Are you to be happy whilst I grovel in wretchedness? Am I to be utterly alone? You can destroy my only hope of love, but you cannot destroy me. Revenge, Frankenstein. I will have my revenge.
You cannot frighten me. I am past fearing.
It is well. I will go. But remember, I shall be with you on your wedding night.
I locked and barred the doors and remained awake all night, watching and waiting. The next day I left and returned with all haste to Switzerland. I would not die so easily. His threat to kill me on my wedding night and so rob Elizabeth of her only love, it did not move me. I would guard myself. I would carry two pistols, day and night. The day of my wedding arrived. Friends and relations flocked to Geneva. Elizabeth looked radiant. I was the happiest of men. The ceremony passed off well, and in the evening everyone came to our villa to celebrate. Everyone was in high spirits, especially my father.
Victor, Victor, why so gloomy?
Hmm?
Oh, no, I remember. Nerves. Nothing to worry about, my boy. I was just the same with your mama. It'll soon be over. And who knows? I might even hope for some grandchildren.
Yes, Father. I will, well.
I shall be with you on your wedding night.
Now, now, Victor, no blushes. Ah, look. There's Elizabeth. I think she wants to dance. I shall leave you two lovebirds to bill and coo, huh?
I shall be with you on your wedding night.
Oh, Victor, there you are. Everyone is asking for you.
I have never known such popularity.
Victor, wait here. I have a very special present for you. It's in my room. I shan't be a minute.
I shall be transfixed until you return, my only love.
I shall be with you on your wedding night.
Elizabeth!
He had killed her. The last object of my love. Destroyed in our very hour of happiness. I will be with you on your wedding night. I must conclude my story. I feel my strength failing. I pursued the creature across Europe. Everywhere he taunted me. I heard his laughter ringing in my head. I saw his face in every passerby. I pursued him, relentlessly, to the north, further north than man has ever ventured before.
And he has escaped me. I have failed. Walton, you must promise me. Take him and destroy him. He must.
Frankenstein? Victor! Victor! Oh, God! He is dead. Gone. Victor! Oh, Victor! You will not fail. I will destroy your creature. He will not escape. He must not. I must go and prepare a coffin to hold his body. I will take it back to England and I will bury him with honor. Now, I must keep the door locked. None of the crew must know that he is dead. They would take that as a bad sign. What is that sound? It is coming from the room where Victor... Oh, God. Perhaps. What if... If it is the creature? Then I can destroy him. Here. I must be quiet. Oh, horrible... He's standing over Victor. He's reaching out. Stop. I command you.
Frankenstein. Not dead. Not dead. Cold. Cold. He cannot answer me. I have destroyed him.
Murderer. Yes, you have destroyed him and all that was dear to him. If you had one shred of conscience...
And do you dream? Do you think that I am dead to agony and remorse? I know what I have done. And yet he knew nothing of my suffering. He could not suffer as I did. Do you think that the screams of his gentle wife were music to my ears? My heart was fashioned to love. To love. But it was wrenched to hatred by my misery. Evil became my good. But now it is ended. Here... is my final victim.
Oh, so now you come to whine over the desolation that you have made. You throw a torch into a burning building, and when it is raised to the ground, you sit among the ruins and lament. You cry now only because the victim of your malice has escaped your power.
It is not so. Not so. I do grieve. You have no ears to hear my story. You have his only.
He could not have known the 10,000th part of my pain. How was I loved? I was hunted like an animal. No man spared me. The cottagers whom I served paid me with hate. The man whose child I saved from drowning paid me with bullets. And yet these are virtuous and immaculate beings.
I, the miserable and the abandoned, am an abortion. To be spurned and kicked and trampled on. Is this justice? You hate me. Yet your loathing cannot equal my self-hatred. It is true. I have murdered the lovely and the innocent. I have no wish to live. My work is now complete. I shall leave your vessel on the ice raft which brought me hither, and I shall go to the uttermost north. There I shall die. I will make a funeral pyre, and I will burn. Burn till there is nothing of me but ash and dust. Nothing will remain. And I shall no longer feel the agonies which now consume me. Frankenstein is dead. He who called me into being. And when I shall be no more, the very memory of us both will fade as stars in the morning. Soon, my burning miseries will be extinct. I shall ascend my funeral pyre in triumph and exult in the agony of the torturing flames. Then the light will fade away, and my ashes will be swept into the sea by the winds. My spirit will sleep in peace. Farewell.
Wait! Wait! Gone. Gone through the cabin window. There. There he is. On the ice floe. Gone.